Hey, what's going on everyone? My name is Gabriel from Archlogbook, and today we are going through the second video of the three-part series, Getting Started with Parametric Design. So, in video 1, we have previously discovered three main topics. The first topic was about the introduction of parametric design and why it is so important and relevant to our architectural design industry. Secondly, we covered the basics of programming. And lastly, we covered the basics of geometry, geometry types, and geometric operations. I will just quickly sum up what we covered last video if you haven't catched it, but I would highly recommend that you would take a look. It's currently on our Archlogbook Instagram page and YouTube. The link is in our bio. So previously we covered all the different types of geometry in parametric design. We covered the types of geometry such as points, vectors, lines, planes, surfaces, boxes, polylines, splines, circles, and cylinders. We also went through the importance of understanding how points and vectors work with one another and how they are being the two most important geometry types that you should be familiar with. Also, we take a look at the ways we can construct these geometry in Rhino and in Revit. But in this tutorial, we will be covering Rhino specifically. We also took a look at the overview of the common geometric operations such as curve, polylines, and surfaces. And we also broke down the three types of geometry operations such as create, transform, and analyze. So, let's go through the contents for this video tutorial. So in part 2 of this video series, we will be covering Rhino and Grasshopper, most specifically on the interface, the components, and the workflow of a parametric design workflow. So here we see many different geometry in the Rhino workspace. We are currently in top view. But if we took a look at all of these geometry, we see points, we see boxes, we see poly surfaces, we see surfaces made from points, a plane, a sphere, a NURBS curve. There are so many different types of geometry that we can create in Rhino. And although Rhino gives us a certain playing field that we can experiment with form and create different geometry, however, what Grasshopper, which is a plugin, offers is an additional layer of flexibility and creativity that comes with parametric design. So without further ado, we will start to launch Grasshopper, and I'll try my best to help you navigate if you're looking at this for the first time, or if you're not familiar with Rhino and Grasshopper. This tutorial will help you understand the basics and to be on your way to discover how you can pursue parametric design in your design workflow. So, without further ado, let's launch Grasshopper. But before I do that, I would like to note that my current Rhino and Grasshopper workspace might differ from yours, and what I've done to my Rhino workspace is actually to not have the toolbars, the default toolbars of all the icons for the operations. I focus on typing commands instead of pressing icons, and thus your workflow may differ from mine, but what is similar is the overall thought process and the general layout. So let me fire up Grasshopper. You can simply do that by typing Grasshopper, G-R-A-S-S, and there you go. Mine's already loaded, but if yours is loading for the first time, you'll see a green pop-up. So here we see Grasshopper. Let me expand this window. So this is a typical Grasshopper interface that you see. Over at the top, we have all the standard menus. We have File, Edit, View, Display, Solution, and Help. I will go through some of the typical settings that I have done later. We also have the ribbon bar with all the different tabs, like parameters, math, sets, vector, curve, and so on. And within each tab, there are icons. So each icon relates to a component that you put into this Grasshopper canvas. So below that, we have the open icon to open another Grasshopper script and to save it. We also have all these zoom options. We have named view, if you want to navigate to select a particular region of the canvas and save it as a name view, you can do so. And over on the right side, you have different display modes. We have don't draw any preview geometry. Later, I'll explain what does preview geometry mean. And over at the right side are more of those settings. And at this main screen, we have the overall canvas. And I hope that you have actually took notes of in the first lesson. So in the first lesson, we went through programming. So programming basics come into play here. We have inputs and outputs and functions. Usually we see the code from left to right, which also corresponds to the way we organize our components in the Grasshopper canvas. So typically we start by adding components of inputs. Inputs such as points, lines, data, numeric data, geometric data. You know it. If you are not sure what are the types of inputs you can put, so you can go to under parameters on the top left tab. Here you see geometry. We have all the different types of inputs. So all these inputs actually correspond to geometry in Rhino. We also have primitive data types, or we can call it native. We have integers, text. We even have file path we can actually link files to. We have numbers and booleans. Followed which we have inputs such as number slider, which is very commonly used. We have panels, we have boolean toggles, all these. We will cover a few of them that are very, very commonly used, and it could be your very first Grasshopper script. And following which, we have more advanced utilities components, which I don't think we need to use yet. In the math, we have domains and matrices if you're more interested in the organizing of data from in sets or in more complex data structures. We will definitely need all these. We have operators, like math operations such as addition, subtraction, multiplication, and so on. You will definitely use some of these. We have all the polynomials, all the cube roots. If you're doing any algebraic operations, you can use all these. Script. This consists of components that you can actually input your own code using C# or Python, which are two programming languages that we can use. We can also input time and date. We also have all these math trigonometric operations. And lastly, all of these more advanced utilities under math. We also have list management. So this is all of the components that corresponds to list methods, as I mentioned last video. We have insert items, we have list index, list item, reverse list, and so on. This is also one of the most commonly used set of components that you will use. We also have sequence. Two of the most commonly used ones are range. Range is it just says a range of numbers. We also have series. Series is also very commonly used. There are also sets, but if you're not sure about sets and data management of sets, in the future maybe we can go through together. And trees are a slightly more complex data structure as compared to lists, and it might be coming up in another video, but I don't intend to go through this. You can also search for data trees on Google or YouTube to find out more about this. Vectors. There are also vector components. Let's jump to planes. So planes, we have, as we can recall, they are create operations, they are analyze operations, they are transform operations. So take a look at all this in your own free time. But there are sometimes we need to understand, if you see the hover over, you see the subtext saying create a plane. So we know that this operation is a create function. So this is one tip that I can offer to help you to familiarize with the use of the components. Following which, we have points. This is also one of the commonly used panels. We have construct point, which I will go through with you in detail. Similarly to deconstruct, we have closest point, which might be also quite commonly used, and so on. All of these takes time to understand, and I wouldn't stress you on this right now. We also have vector. So we have deconstruct vector, which is actually quite similar to deconstruct point, which I will go through in detail. We have vector XYZ. Basically, it's to construct a vector. We see create. Again, this is a create operation. Unit vector is a direction that we can unitize. Unit X, a unit vector that is parallel to the world X axis. That means it's one unit. We can actually negate the magnitude of the vector. Same as for Y and Z. This is all corresponding to the Rhino X, Y, and Z coordinates. We also have amplitude to find the length of the vector. We also have a vector that we can create from two points. And we can also calculate the length through either the amplitude or we can also set the length of the vector. Curve. We have also have curve analysis, transformation, and create functions. So here we see the analysis functions. I wouldn't be too worried about all of these yet. Mainly the most common ones we use are the endpoints and as well as the evaluate length, maybe also curve closest point, division. We can also take note of all of these most commonly used ones. Divide curve, divide distance, divide length. If you are interested in knowing more, I will show you a resource later that we can go through all of the components. Moving quickly, we have primitive circles, we have lines, we can create polygons through this panel of components. Spline, also the same. We can create interpolated curves through a set of points. NURBS curve, polyline, all of these are here. We can also analyze curves. We can also see how we can flip the curves, we can transform them, or we can fillet them, project. Here, you see all of these components are actually somewhere here that once you are familiarized with this, you are able to either use the panels to get the component you want, or you can actually double click and to search for the component. Moving quickly, there is also surface components, surface analysis components to get the edge curves of a B-wrap, which is a representative of a boundary. We have the area, we can get the volume of the B-wrap. Under freeform, we can also create surfaces from all of these methods. We can also transform them. We can create via a extrusion or a sweep or a loft, which is a very commonly used surface creation method. We have all the primitive forms that we can create, such as boxes, spheres, cone, and cylinder. We have the utilities, transforming surfaces. We can divide them, we can cap the holes. As mentioned in the previous video, we have offset surface. And we also have mesh operation, because we can also create or to analyze the mesh. These ones are more advanced. Intersect, this is one of the most commonly used panels as well. So if you see B-wrap and the single straight line and line, which means we would like to solve the intersection events of a B-wrap and a line to see whether we can obtain a particular point or a line. We can also see a bunch of intersection events based on the different input required. We also have more of these intersection components. We can also split or to trim with B-wraps. Or we can also do the same for solids, solid union, solid difference, solid intersection. Under transform, we have all of the standard transform operations in scale. We have shear, project. We have arrays, which is the multiplication of a certain direction of items. Box array, linear array, and so on. We have the standard Euclidean operations. We have more advanced transformation operations that I typically do not use. We also have group, ungroup. They are all here. That's what you expect in a design software. You can also find it in Grasshopper. Display is also a very important panel. Here we can see the colors that we can create. They will link to your preview elements. We also have dimensions. You can also make 2D, which is a way of making drawings out of 3D objects and projecting it into 2D drawings. Previously, it was only available in Rhino as before Rhino 6, but now in Rhino 6, Grasshopper allows make 2D components, which is potentially very powerful. We have graphs that we can output or display based on the data that we can input. You can also have a custom preview. That means you can adjust the color, the size, and so on. You can also adjust the display of vectors and points. Points list will be able to identify for us the points listed in the sequence of the output. That means if the output is a list of points, if we plug it into this points list, we click it, click here, we can input a list of points and then we can display the points list in Rhino based on the selected sequence based on the list itself. So, and Kangaroo is just a structural analysis thing that comes pre-packaged in Rhino 6. So, yeah, looking through all of these panels, I hope this gives you an idea of the possibilities that you can create using the Grasshopper Canvas. And first of all, I want to show you what I'll be doing with Grasshopper today, and I hope you can follow along. So here you see, let's zoom out a bit. All of these components constitute to one code. And what I just did was actually to select all of the components and to group them using the middle mouse button. Let me do that again. Let me ungroup this first. Right click, ungroup. Crossing window using the left mouse button. So, middle mouse button. If you click the middle mouse button, you see all of these options. This is group. Group means grouping all the components. If you click that, you have a region of all the components that is grouped within. And to understand how components work, once you have selected your component from the panel, they will appear in this canvas. And from left to right, we see input and we see output. And if you don't see the full name of the component, you can toggle that by pressing press display and enable draw full names. So personally, I prefer to see the component name instead of the icons. And from left to right, we see the input going through the function, which is deconstruct in this place, and the outputs. In this case, the outputs are the X, Y, and Z component of the point. This is the deconstruct point component. And one thing to note is connecting components is as simple as dragging from left to right. So let's say, for example, if I want to have a point, I can use double click anywhere in the canvas and search for it, point, enter. So this is a currently empty point parameter input. So what you can do is actually to to reference a point on the canvas in Rhino. So what you can do is, back if you go to Rhino, let me make this smaller. You can select a point in Rhino. You can just create a point by pressing point on the Rhino interface. You can click a crossing window and select the point in Rhino and head over to Grasshopper. You can right click the component, set one point. You can click it again. So you have referenced the point on the Grasshopper canvas, and this is your very first step. Before I go any further, let me show you what I'll be doing together with you. So over here you see some kind of like a red color preview geometry. It's actually not in Rhino. If I try to do a crossing window, it's actually not part of Rhino yet. what I'm trying to accomplish today is, and to show you the workflow about, is having a point in the Rhino canvas and bringing that into Grasshopper and trying to toggle between how high the building is. Oh, that was the wrong parameter. Okay, how high the building is. You can play with the number of levels. We can adjust the height of the building. We can also play with the curvature of the building that corresponds to the radius of each level. So how this works is, if I go to the top view, okay, let me switch this up. So usually we work in multiple viewports. So let me adjust it a little. Okay. Yep. So we have a graph of sorts where, let's say, this point is the origin, 0, 0, and whatever curve I draw, so this curve is also referenced in Grasshopper, and all of these lines are also referenced in Grasshopper. So whatever you see in red, and this curve is referenced in Grasshopper. So what I can play is with the curve that I adjust. What this does is, I can have a curve that intersects with all these curves that represents a value. So this direction is the y, this direction is x. Yep, so all of these points intersect with the red lines, and it corresponds to a certain value that would translate into the radius of, each floor plate of this building. And the higher, that means the more positive direction, which is the above, compared to this origin point, the higher it is, the bigger radius it is. And that will correspond to each level. So let's say this point represents, maybe this is 3 units. This is 3.4, 3.5, 3.6, 3.7. And then maybe it goes down to back to 3.4. All of these values translates to the radius of each floor plate from bottom to top. And the number of data points, it should be the same as this. So if I adjust it more, so in this case, the radius actually goes down a little bit and then goes up. And you see here, it goes down and goes up. So yeah, this is the overall thing that I would like to try to explain to you, and to hopefully this will help you get started in a very simple way of understanding the workflow and the thought process. So looking at the Grasshopper code from left to right, so this point is actually the graph origin point. We use that to create the origin of the graph. To create this line, I use the move tool. I created an array. After that, I had an input curve that I can adjust. And I would like to solve for the intersection. And I can get these points, and to calculate the difference in y value from this origin point, that would be passed into the creation of the circle radius of each floor plate. And then I would loft this each curve and to get a continuous surface that represents the building. So I have all of basically whatever I'm circling right now until the array with the deconstruct and the move, unit y, line, absolute, linear array. All of these form the first part of the code, which is to get this graph. The second part of the code is to have this curve, which is the black curve, you see. And we can solve the intersection to get all of these points to get the corresponding values of the change in y magnitude. So you can see here the intersection of curve A, which is the green one currently, and curve B, which is the list of lines. And then I get the difference in y value of this point and this point. Remember, y value is in Rhino coordinate system. We get the absolute value because we wanted to make it positive. And using the panel component, which is very quick, easy to use and very helpful, you can plug in any output into the panel component and we get to understand this is a list of values. And passing these values, which corresponds now to the relative or maybe absolute radius of the circle of each floor, and then we can loft them. We can also get the areas of each level, and we can show the areas in 3D as well. You see 875.34, which is the area of the uppermost story. We can also change the size of the text. We can play around with the colors later on, and we lastly can also cap the overall geometry, and to if you want to bring it back into the Rhino interface, we can do so later. So yes, this is the overview of the code, and I will take a short moment for you to absorb what you've just heard from me as I try to disable all of these components. So what I can do this code from scratch.